It's a very good morning and welcome back to Urban Today. My name is Henry Sekanjako. We're coming to you to the second and last segment of Urban Today. And of course, like we have told you earlier on, we're going to be talking about the youth in politics. It's an electoral period and most of the youth in Uganda have embraced, you know, politics. And of course, today I've been joined by Hashia Sovereign, and she'll be talking to us about this topic. And good morning to you, Hashia.
Good morning.
How do you pronounce your name?
I am Hasasha Sovereign.
All right. Okay, Sovereign is from Buteleja District. She's a social scientist, politician, and human rights activist. She's the secretary for female youth at Buteleja District, and she's currently aspiring to join the National Youth Council as the female youth affairs representative. All right. To start off this topic, let's start with you joining politics. What inspired you to join politics?
Okay, basically, as a person, I'm so passionate about serving humanity. So that only drives me, to serve people. So any opportunity which comes around, if it's about serving humanity, then I'll grab it. So that is why I came into politics.
Okay, when you talk about serving people, what do you mean? Are you, you know, ready to die for your people, to die for the youth? Give us a little more about this.
Sometimes you find that people come into politics, but then they're coming with selfish interest. Maybe they're coming with different reasons. But when you're coming into leadership, you need to come when you're ready to serve. So some people maybe might come because they want to be served, but basically me, I'm in politics because I want to serve people. I want to serve humanity. That is what drives me to come into politics.
All right. You talked about people joining police because they have different interests. Some go there for money.
True.
All right. Yeah. Let's talk about you, you know, wanting to represent the youth. You just won the post for secretary, female youth affairs at Buteleja District. Why do you want to represent the youth at the National Youth Council?
There are many positions in the National Youth Council. First of all, National Youth Council, it is a council which brings up all youth leaders in different districts, and they come together to manage their affairs in the National Youth Council. So there are many positions. There's chairperson, there's the one in charge of finance, there's sports, but there's a lot. But then I came in specifically to represent the female youth. This is because I know the challenges which the female youth are facing. So that is the reason why I'm coming to represent the female youth. Because as we all know that female youth go through a lot of challenges. For example, sexual reproductive health issues. You find out that most of our girls, they don't have pads, you know. You find out that they cannot even attend school. So when government, in hospitals or in dispensers, sometimes you find they're offering free condoms. So if government can offer free condoms, or even other societal organizations can offer free condoms, why can they also offer free pads to our young girls who cannot afford pads? Also, concerning the issue of pads, we can also look at the project of making reusable pads to our girls, like those ones who cannot afford to buy on the shops. Then we also have problems of teenage pregnancies. Actually, in Uganda, research shows that 25% we record teenage pregnancies every year. So in sub-Saharan Africa, research shows that we have a lot of teenage pregnancies in sub-Saharan Africa. So all those challenges, they drive me to represent the female youth. We can also look at challenges of when this female youth, maybe when they get pregnant, sometimes they find out that their parents are chasing them away, you know? Maybe there is a way they are treating them. But that is not the way to go. Maybe if, let me say, a girl gets pregnant, you're not supposed to chase them away, because sometimes they're going through a lot. And sometimes maybe you find out that maybe the boy or the man who impregnated them, they're not ready to take care of them. So you cannot push them. When you push them, it is, you know, it is too much on them. So despite maybe a girl gets pregnant, I know we can, as a social scientist, because I'm a social scientist, I'm also going to look at the program of offering psychosocial support to these ladies, such that we can guide them, we can tell them it is not the end of the world, not only them, but also the parents. We incorporate them, that they should not chase them away. We can still embrace them. Maybe they can go back to school. In case they cannot go back to school, still we can maybe give them skills like hairdressing, such that they can improve on their livelihoods. Then also concerning, I'm also going to look at the challenges whereby there's sexual harassment in universities, in different spheres of life. So those are the challenges girls are facing. Then I'm also going to represent not only the girl, but also the boy child. So you find out that youth, most of the time we are asked for work experience. And yet in universities, we have been offered education, good education. We have the skills, we have the ideas. You know, we go in for internships. Basically, I went in for internship for twice. So, and you ask yourself, there is no specific school for experience, but you're asking someone from university, you want experience of 10 years, you want experience of 15 years.
So how do you plan to do that? Because that's what companies ask for. Are you going to start up a company and then take through these people, you know, graduates? How do you plan to do that?
I'm going to advocate to our dear employers in government, in civil society organizations, in different spheres. They shouldn't ask for a lot of experience, because I believe when we train our youth from the university, because I believe even when you train someone can easily pick up. Me, I've seen youth who have done jobs they have not studied for, but they are trained. So we shouldn't ask for experience of 20 years or 15 years. That is one of the causes of having high rates of unemployment.
So you think that bid for, you know, experience should be waived off by companies?
Yes, such that our youth, we can reduce on the high rates of unemployment.
All right. You've talked about, you know, you've told us about the challenges that the youth, you know, face in this country, you know, lack of access to health services. But you find that some of these services are there, they've been provided by government, but maybe the leaders have not done enough to, you know, make sure that younger people are aware about these services and they access them. Do you think it's the problem is with government or our leaders?
No, the problem is not with government. And the problem is not with the leaders.
Where is it?
What I'm talking about, I'm not saying government hasn't done anything. I really appreciate the good work done by the government so much.
Sure.
So they've availed the services, like just as I was telling you, that condoms, they can be put in dispensers in hospitals. There are free services in the hospitals, like maybe family planning methods and so on. But my I'm advocating for is, instead of us, yes, we can offer free condoms, it is okay, but then we should look also at critical things, because we know that sex is a choice, but menstruation period, it is a must. It is biological. Every month a girl has to go through what? Menstrual cycle. So if we can offer the basics, so let me say we offer free pads. We say, now in these hospitals, we are giving such pads. Maybe in these hospitals, we are giving such. So that one can also help in issues concerning health issues.
The government recently, I think about 1 or 2 years ago, it came out to promise, you know, pads to the young people. But up to now, those pads have never come through, the sanitary pads. Don't you think this is a disservice to the young people?
It is. That is why we are coming out to advocate for it. I'm coming out to advocate for it, because I believe as a youth, we cannot be passive participants. about issues affecting us, you have to come out and express yourself.
Mm.
Yeah.
Many youth have embraced politics. Do you blame this? Do you think their coming out is because the current leaders, especially the older ones, have not done enough to help the young people? And what do you think about the current crop of leaders in the country?
Youth coming into politics, it is a good thing.
Mm.
Because 845 million people in Africa are youth. And Uganda, we have the greatest generation of the youth. So youth, we have the power, and we are the greatest. So coming into politics, it is because we have to get involved in decision-making processes. We have to get involved in the electoral processes. We have to air out issues affecting us. Mm. So that is why we come out, because we are the greatest. So we have to come out, we speak issues affecting us. We represent the greatest generation. So I really embrace youth coming into politics, because we are the future, but the future is starting from now. So it is our time to take action. It is our time to move on.
All right. We have had youth leaders, before, ever since, Parliament introduced the, representation for special groups, where even youth, fall, and then other platforms at the national level. But many people say that youth leaders have not done enough to help the youth that they represent. How different are you going to be from these people?
First of all, I'm different because I'm a leader who wants to create a difference. I don't just go into politics to fill positions, but I am going into politics. Actually, I've been a politician because, all along, even from university, I was the Minister of Gender, I was the Guild Member of Parliament of our College of Humanities and Social Sciences. So I've been in leadership.
Mm.
And one of what makes me different, it is because I have values. And these values are the ones which drive me to become a better leader. And one of them is integrity. Then I also have compassion. And I also like teamwork.
Mm.
I like teamwork. I like working as a team, because I believe issues affecting the youth are beyond one person. It is beyond sovereign. It is beyond the other person. But we are going to have a team. So I believe I'm going to collect all the voices of the youth, and we work together as a team. So I love teamwork. Then I also am a hardworking lady. Then discipline. As youth, we need to have discipline. So that drives us. And that is what makes me to be a different leader.
And is this a concern that, I know you're standing on the NRM ticket, right?
Yes.
And the youth, especially, the concerns that when you people, get these positions, you tend to, to front more your party positions than the issues that are affecting the youth in the country. How do you plan to go about this?
Of course, if you're coming under the party, first of all, I respect my party NRM so much, and I believe in their values, I believe in their principles. So the good thing, what the government has done, or what the party has done, that is NRM, it has given us opportunities, it has given us platform for the youth, to come out and represent the issues affecting the young people. So I really credit our government because of that. But when we come into leadership, we serve all the youth. Mm. We don't only serve the youth of the movement, or we don't only serve the youth, different in our political parties. No, when we come into politics, you are going to serve the interests of the party, but you're also, the main goal is serving the issues or tackling issues which are affecting the youth, because that is the reason why you're there.
Mm.
Yeah, so you have
so
to.
So we're not seeing you taking sides at me. This money should only support the NRM youth.
No, 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 because you're representing all the youth in the country. So you have to advocate for them. You have to, to work for them, for all the youth, no matter the party they're in, as long as you get into there.
Okay. You've been in the youth movement for quite a long time. You're a youth yourself. What do you think are some of the most pressing issues that are affecting the youth in Uganda?
Just as I told you, we have high rates of unemployment. Then we also, just as I was telling you about the female youth, we have a lot of teenage pregnancies.
Mm.
Then we find out that youth are really facing a lot of poverty. They are poor. You find, especially sometimes, you know, the allies, maybe the youth in Kampala, but me, I'm looking at all, even a youth in the village, even a youth who has not gone to school, you know, someone maybe who cannot even afford to get 1,000 shillings, you know, let me say in a day. So youth are really facing a lot of challenges.
Mm. Yeah. And of course, the government whose ticket you're going to use has come up with programs before,
yeah.
Youth Capital Venture Fund, the Youth Life Program. And all these programs are aimed at, you know, improving the livelihoods for the young people in the country. But you find that most of the youth have not benefited from these programs. Where do you think the problem is?
To me, I think the problem is about sensitization.
Mm.
There is lack of sensitization. There are programs are there for the youth, for example, like what you have mentioned, youth livelihood programs. But you find out that our youth are not sensitized enough about these programs. So we need to do more, you know? We need to advocate more. We need to tell our youth that, you know what, there's such and such a program, can you engage in? Because you find out that there are some youth, they could even get this youth livelihood program and they use it and they don't return it. Why? Because they are not sensitized enough how they should do it, how they should handle this program. So to me, I think we need to increase more on sensitization about the youth programs, not only in the city, but even deep down in the villages, because we have youth structures. Now, like in our elections, we started from the village level.
Mm.
We had to go to parish level. We had to go to sub-county. Then we went at the district. Now we are going at the nationals.
Sure.
So even when it comes to programs, let it be, you know, let it flow like that. Let it come from national, let it go from then to district, then sub-county, then the village, such that all the youth leaders, they can spearhead this. Because the youth in the villages, the youth in the sub-counties, the youth in the districts, they are coming out because they want to represent the youth, you know, in that particular district or in that particular area. So we should not just give them those positions, but we have to empower them. We have to empower them such that they can be able to give information to other youth.
Of course, people are blaming you as youth leaders that it's not necessarily about sensitizing these people. Even you people have you know, a role to play that you have to sensitize these guys, because most of them have been given money and they don't implement the programs they're supposed to use this money for. They just eat it. So you're also partly to blame because you have not sensitized youth, yet you're their leaders.
We are doing our part. I can't say that it is all done. You know, I can't rule out that.
Mm.
So we have to continue. We have to continue doing it from different parts of the country. We sensitize them about how they should use this, you know, this fund.
Mm.
Yeah.
All right, you're still watching Urban Today. My name is Henry Sekanjako. And in the studio is Hasha Sovereign. She's from Buteleja District. And she's a social scientist, politician, human rights activist. She's currently the Secretary for Female Youth Affairs at Buteleja District. And she's aspiring to join the National Youth Council as the Female Youth Affairs Representative. You can join us, you can join the conversation on our socials, that's Urban Television on Facebook, Urban TV Uganda on Twitter, Seka Henry on all platforms, Lin UG3 on Twitter, Lin Comgish on Facebook, and share your thoughts with us. What do you think is the most pressing issue that is affecting the youth in our country? Sovereign, let us talk about money in politics. We understand it's a big issue that is affecting the youth across board.
Yeah.
Most of them want to join politics, but of course they're limited by money.
Yes.
How big is this problem?
It is a very big challenge because our politics, it is now so much commercialized.
Mm.
And I'm really against it. I blame it 100% because I believe it's all about looking at capabilities. It's all about looking at competence. So we shouldn't vote people just because they have money, but we should look at their agenda. What do they have? So when youth are coming into politics, maybe they are coming in youth positions, or they are coming for members of parliament, or they are competing for local councils in any, you know, in any political space. So I believe we can give them chance as long as we listen to their agenda, as long as they are willing to serve the interests of their people, though they don't have money. Because, you know, when you're youth, especially, you have just, like those ones who have studied, you have just come out of campus, you're looking for what to do, so you don't have a lot of money. So what I'm asking is we should look at capabilities, or we should look at competences and the agenda that person has for that particular political office, then we offer them a platform. Let us not look at money, but let us look at what someone is going to do in those maybe 5 years, in that particular time, then we can support them.
Are you suggesting that, because there's a view by some Ugandans that electoral commission should waive off nomination fees for, you know, candidates that are aspiring to run for different offices. So is it your view that, you know, especially for the youth, that they should be exempted from, you know, paying things like nomination fees? Because we understand that in the recent nominations that were conducted by the National Electoral Commission, most of the youth were edged out because they didn't have money to pay for nominations.
Mm.
So is it your view that, do you share the same view with some Ugandans that maybe Electoral Commission should consider waiving of these fees, especially for the youth?
In my own view, when you're coming into a political office, I would suggest that you need to be prepared. And to me, I really want someone, like, especially when you're coming into political office, you need to have nomination fees. So I believe,
but
as long as you're determined,
but
you
but
can look for
but some of these
it.
Guys at university, like yourself,
yes.
Okay, you completed, but then at some point,
mm.
you were at university, and recently, in the recent nominations, I saw a 22-year-old man or boy coming out to nominate for MP. And you imagine that, you know, such a person is not working.
Yeah.
So there's no way they can save, but then they don't have any income.
True. But...
So when you say that maybe they should be prepared, how can they be prepared when they're at school?
You can... What I know, it's about in politics, there is what we call making relations and making connections.
Mm.
So if you have your... If you have your agenda, and you sell it out, you know, to different people, they can support you, you know.
Mm.
They can support you. Basically, like me, as I'm coming to my youth politics, one of, he's called Emmanuel Dombo, one of our politicians in our village.
Mm.
So he has really been of help to me. So this is because I reached out to him, then I told him the agenda I have.
Okay.
So he can support. So I believe even in different places, you know, you can approach our leaders, or you can even approach, you know, different people, even your family, and you tell them, I have this agenda. Can you support me with the nomination fees? Then other things will come. So, but...
So for you, don't agree that... Electoral Commission should deal with these fees. They should hold them.
They should hold them. Maybe what I can advise is they can reduce on the amount.
Okay.
But the nomination fees, it has to be there.
Mm.
Yeah.
So you think these...
But you can look for it.
Mm, these fees help us to sieve out those that are not competent enough.
And even running the activities, because Electoral Commission has a lot of activities to run. And they cannot depend on government alone. So these fees they collect, they always help them to run, you know, to run the activities in the entire country. So to me, I know, yes, youth, we are struggling, we are going through a lot, but when it comes to nomination fees, sincerely, you should come into an election when you're prepared and we can have nomination fees.
You people are trying to edge out your competitors, those without money.
We are not. We are not. As long as you have your agenda is clear, yes, people will always help you.
All right.
Yeah.
There's been a concern lately, especially during the party primaries, and we have seen a lot of violence, and most of the people are blaming this on the youth. Why are youth promoting violence in elections?
I condemn violence in elections 100%. One of course, the challenges we have sometimes as youth is because sometimes we find out that different politicians are using us to fight. They're using us, you know, to fight against each other, to promote their political agenda. But I would urge you, as youth, we should not be used on that. We should be youth with a difference. We should be youth who are willing to create a positive impact in our society. Not being used, you know, to make violence, not being used, you know, to do dirty things. No, I believe we can have youth who are going to impact societies positively. So we can go away with violence, we can go away with drug abuse, we can go away with all the associated, you know, challenges which are faced by the youth.
Sure.
Yeah.
And nominations are on, especially for presidential candidates. And we have seen that on the second and third, all presidential aspirants will be, you know, nominated. Those that have submitted, they've been verified by the Electoral Commission. And they will, you know, launch their manifestos. As a youth representative, what do you want to see covered in these manifestos to help the youth?
Okay, thank you so much. I have a lot. I want the youth to have meaningful participation, you know, in decision-making processes. They should involve us in decision-making processes because we have issues affecting us. So I believe we can, you know, we can speak or we can air out those issues which are affecting us more. So we should be involved in the decision-making processes. Then,
when you say decision-making, what do you want? Like when bills come to parliament, you want to be called upon? You know, tell us a little more about it.
Youth can be involved in decision-making process. For example, we have 5 youth MPs for the youth. So, to me, I would suggest, I wish we would have like sub-regional MPs.
On top of the 5 we have?
Yes. Because
what difference would they make? Because even the 5 we have in parliament have not done enough. Because you talked about unemployment as one of the challenges that is affecting the youth in Uganda.
Yeah.
And the youth have been represented in parliament for a long time.
Yeah.
And the 5 MPs, youth MPs, have not done enough to address this problem because it keeps on coming up every now and then. And then you're calling for regional MPs. What difference would they make?
To me, I think when you join hands or when you join efforts, you can air out issues more. Because sometimes you find out that sometimes they're left out just because, you know, the number is not enough. But if we can also have sub-regional MPs, or even when we get a youth MP, maybe, you know, from, let me say, you know, in different sub-regions, you find out that they can air out our issues because they are having, you know, let me say in a sub-region, they're having like, let me say 8 districts or 9 districts or 10 districts, than one MP who is in the whole region, let me say Eastern, you're supposed to be in Teso, you're supposed to be in Bugisu, you're supposed to be in Ibukedi. So it is just a lot of work. But when we can have these sub-regional MPs, to me, I think our youth in parliament, they can really be active and they can create a difference. We shouldn't say that, you know, if these ones maybe who are in parliament have not done something, then we keep quiet over it. No, we cannot keep quiet.
Okay.
We'll always want people to come out and they air out the issues of the youth.
How often do you, you know, as youth, interact with these leaders at a national level? And when you interact with them, do you share your, you know, some of the challenges that affect you, and how far have they gone to address these challenges?
Of course, we try to talk to them, to those who can reach us, because there are those ones, there are some, when they go into office, they don't come back, because you'll always see them coming in different districts, in different regions, when it's time for campaigning. But when they're into office, then it is a done deal. You know, they don't do that, you know, what they did before they went into an office. So to me, I would advise what you're doing during campaigns or for you to get there, then maintain that, you know. It is good to maintain that such that, you know, you can be in touch, you know, with the youth from this district. You can be in touch with the youth from the other, and they will tell you their challenges. Because youth in different areas, they face different challenges. So it is always good to go to grassroots, then get the challenges which are affecting the youth. Then you come into parliament and you air out the issues which are affecting the youth.
Yeah, before we, you know, we dived into, you know, issues affecting the youth, we're talking about the manifesto.
Yeah.
And you told us, you know, that you want to be involved in decision making. Besides decision making, what is that thing that affects the youth the most that you want these different presidential candidates to cover in their manifesto?
Youth being the greatest generation, we are facing a lot of unemployment. Most of our youth are poor. So the presidential candidates, I would advise them to really consider the youth being the majority of the population. They shouldn't just be left out, but we should look at issues affecting the youth, for example, unemployment. Then we can also talk about health issues, which are affecting also the youth. Then providing quality education to our youth, especially down there in the villages. Because you can find out that education is there, but it's not of quality. And some of the youth, that is the option which is there, you know, the UP or the youth, you know. So we should equip our youth also with skills. So the presidential candidates can also embark on skilling our youth. Because not only that when you go to school that is when you can succeed. I believe even youth who are doing skilling, who are doing, for example, like hairdressing, who are doing carpentry, and many other skills, engineering. So these youth are also earning money and they can improve on their livelihoods. So we can also look at skilling the youth.
Among all the issues that you've talked about, skilling the youth, you know, providing health services, education services, government has tried.
Yeah.
But the issue of unemployment still stands out.
Sure.
It's a concern that, you know, has been raised by the youth time and again. As a youth leader, what do you think, you know, the current government can do, or what do you think as a country we can do to ensure that we address the issue of unemployment in Uganda?
First and foremost, I would go to my first point, which I talked about work experience. We should reduce the number of years we are asking the youth for experience. Because just from the university, why would you ask me 10 years experience? Or why would you ask me 15 years experience? Really? It is really unfair. Because I've been at school, I've attained skills, I have ideas, you know, I've been trained. Why don't you offer me a chance? So asking for, you know, a lot of experience, it is really not good. It is, I would advise our government or different employers, we should consider our youth, because there is no specific training for the youth. There is no specific institution, let me say, for experience, that maybe you're from university, then you're going in this institution for training of experience of what? Of 10 years or 15 years. So just I would advise that we give our youth job opportunities if they're there. Let us reduce on the number of years of experience. We can also reduce on that, on the number of on high rates of unemployment. Then we can also look at skilling the youth, because there are many youth who are into agriculture. There are many youth who are doing different skilling. So we can also empower them, because sometimes you want to start out maybe a business, you want to start up something, but you don't have capital. So at least if you're given capital, if our youths, whom they know that, you know, they have proof that you're doing something, they know the business is there, they can give you capital, then, you know, you start out from there.
Yeah, you've talked about skills, and one would say that we are promoting laziness among the youth. When we say that when someone graduates, they should find a job in a certain organization. Yet when you go to university, we acquire skills, you know, as graduates and all that. We acquire skills, meaning we can start up our own businesses. Don't you think it's high time as a country, you know, we started promoting, innovativeness amongst the youth, and then, because when we do that, many youth will start up their own ventures, and then we'll leave this thing of, you know, have to wait for a job from government or a certain organization.
Yes, that is.
Do you think even the youth are a bit lazy?
There are some, but there are those ones. I believe there are youth outside there who are so creative, who are so innovative. Mm. And those youth can be supported. And I would also advise our fellow youth to think outside the box, you know, to think beyond, maybe after your university. You yourself, you can create up something, and you can start from there, instead of maybe just sitting at home waiting, you know, for you to get into an office. You can start with anything, you know, even though you are an elite, but you can start with anything which is available, such that, you know, you can start from there. Maybe from there you can get connections. So we shouldn't despise any opportunities. And those youth who are creative, who are innovative, those ones can also be supported, because I've seen youth who are creative, who are innovative, but sometimes they're limited because of what? Money, as I was saying. But if they can also be supported, then it can be good for our youth.
All right. Yes. Of course, away from politics, Sovereign, I want us to talk about, you know, the girl child in Uganda, and then how COVID has affected the youth. I understand you come from Butaleja district, and you spend some time in Kampala. As a youth leader, how has COVID affected youth in the country, and what should the government do to address some of the concerns that have come up?
About the girl child?
No. Let's start with COVID. How has COVID affected the youth in the country?
COVID has affected so much the youth, because you find out that most companies or most employers, they laid off most of their workers. So you find out that now most of our youth, they're unemployed, they're seated home. Then those ones also who have been in universities, who have been maybe in secondary schools, you find out that right now they are not in school, because it's only the finalists who went. But then these are the, you know, these are the levels. They are still at home. So that only it is a challenge to you. You know, you've been studying, but you know, now you're not studying. So it becomes also a challenge. First of all, even psychologically, because I was interacting with some, and they're like, you know, they've given up on education, some of them, but then you keep on encouraging them, you know, it is not the end of it all. You can continue engaging yourselves in different, maybe research, you can be creative. So those are some of the challenges. Then we also have a lot of teenage pregnancies. So basically those are the challenges our youth are facing outside there.
Okay. And what can government do to address some of these challenges? Because we have seen most of the girls have gotten pregnant and they are home. Parents cannot, you know, most of them have not been working. They cannot afford money to take them back to school. So what can the government do to address some of these challenges that you've highlighted?
To me, I would think, in case maybe a girl got pregnant, maybe during this lockdown, maybe she was at campus, maybe she was in secondary school. I don't think we would treat them bad or would chase them away. I think we can still, you know, incorporate them. We can still talk to them that despite the mistake you've done, you're still important and still you can make a difference. It is not the end of it all. So we can advise them to maybe get back to school when they're done, maybe their delivery. Then we can also advise them, maybe they can even, there are those ones who can do skilling, so they can go also into skilling. Then basically we should just involve our youth that they are more and more active and they can raise our voices wherever they are.
All right. Of course, as a country, you know, we tend to neglect the importance of youth, right? And I wanted to pick your mind on what you on how important you think the youth resource is in the development of our country, as of course we bring this to an end.
To me, I believe we should consider the youth because, first of all, as I was saying, we are the highest population. Then, as youth, we have the energy, you know? We have the power. I know we have the youth who are vibrant. We have the youth who are willing to create a difference, not only in their families, but in their communities, in their country, and even internationally. So we have youth who are willing to create a positive impact in our societies. So let us incorporate them. We appreciate the good work our youth, we appreciate the good work the government has done to offer a platform for the youth, but just as like Oliver Twist, we still demand for more.
Sure. Yeah. Of course, it's a political period, and in 2 months we'll be headed for the national polls. That was next year. And many people are warming up. What would be your message to the youth out there? We have seen, you know, quite a number of, you know, sins, violence, violent sins in the past, and most of the people have blamed the youth for these sins, violent sins. So how do you, what would be your advice to the youth out there?
My advice to the youth outside there is, first of all, I should come into leadership because you want to serve. Above all, that is the most important thing. Come into leadership because you want to serve. Secondly, we should not be used as youth. You need to value yourself. You need to know that you have the power, you have the energy, and you can create a positive impact. So don't allow anyone to use you for maybe something which is not right.
Okay.
So always, always do what? Always be focused, then be determined, then we should not fight each other as youth. We should always encourage each other. Even when you are in these competitions, let me say, you know, we are competing for different offices. We should fight to win, but we should not fight our fellow candidates. So we should always work together as youth, because I know when we work together, we can create a change. When we work together, we can be youth with a difference. When we work together, we can move forward, because I believe when we have collective voices as youth, then we can stand out, then we are the future, because our country is to have self-sustaining economies, then we need the youth. And as they say that we are the future, but to me I say the future is starting from today. So we have to come out, be active participants. Our time is now to rise up and change the world and create positive impact in the world.
All right, thank you very much, Sovereign. Now you heard it from Sovereign. She's of course, from Botaleja District. She's a youth leader, and she's aspiring to join the National Youth Council as a youth, female youth affairs representative. Thanks so very much for joining us, and it was good having you.
Thank you so much for having me.
All right, we'll stop for a break. When we come back, we'll be diving into the entertainment news. Keep it right here.